Good morning. This is the day the Lord has made, and we shall continue to rejoice and be glad in it. Good and great morning to you on the Lord's day. I greet you in the love of God and the sweet communion of God's holy presence. My brothers and sisters, just a pastoral word this morning, very briefly. On the new week coming, June 1st through June 3rd, the 6th Episcopal District, the SED, our state of Georgia, will have its post-planning meeting, guess where? In Columbus, Georgia, right here in the Great Fountain City area. And I invite you to join us from June 1st to the June 3rd. Now, there are different schedules out on the internet. Facebook has a great schedule for us. I'm not going to attempt to tell you the daily process that happens. However, if you would look on Facebook, you can find those schedules for the daily and nightly experiences. There will be worship, there will also be workshops, and there will of course be opportunities to learn what's happening in the state of Georgia as far as African Methodism and politics is concerned. I invite you to join me. I'll be there from June 1st through June 3rd. And with that comes some responsibility that we have, and we're looking forward to taking care of that. Thank you so much, and may the Lord be with you on this day.
Today is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Greetings, St. John family, and welcome to today's virtual worship experience. Please be reminded that members of the finance team will be here today from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. to receive your tithes and offerings. You may also take advantage of use of our Cash App. Please be reminded that God loves a cheerful giver. And now let us be blessed with a word from our pastor, Reverend Washington.
Once again, thank you for joining us on this, a holiday weekend. We want to pause and remember those who lost their life in serving in the armed forces on this weekend. We remember that on Memorial Day, we remember those who gave life for others to have life. If you have lost a family member, a friend, a colleague, or even an enemy. In the case of this kind of experience, we want to honor and we want to respect them. Beloved, we pray for their families and we pray for a nation, for people who thought that they were fighting a war to end all wars. Our brothers and sisters, take time to pause and enjoy yourself this weekend, this four-day weekend, remembering that someone gave their life so that we could enjoy ours. Let us pray and invite God into our virtual experience now that we can hear what God has to say. God, we invite you this morning into this moment together. We thank you for all that you have done. We thank you for all that you're going to do. And in the space we have this morning, we invite you to show us what you're doing. We need you to speak through this, your servant. Hide me behind your anointing and cross and stand boldly on this, the Lord's day. Speak to us, O God, for we need to hear a word from you. Have your way. Through Christ, who is our Lord, risen and Savior, we say amen. Thank you so very much this morning for joining us again. I invite you now to what should be the final edition of our Resurrection Theology, the Motown edition. I've enjoyed presenting it, and I've enjoyed sharing and learning about the wonderful ways of Motown and how theologically sound Motown has been. Today, I invite you to the Old Testament, to possibly the last edition of the Motown Resurrection Theology. Here in the Old Testament, there is a prophet that speaks to us. In the book of Habakkuk, Habakkuk is a minor prophet, Habakkuk chapter 1, and a few of those verses. I invite you to join me this day with the digital copy of the English translation of the Old Testament, the Hebrew text, Habakkuk chapter 1, Habakkuk verses 1 through 7. Let's join and hear what God has to say. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help, and you will not hear, or cry to you violence, and you will not save? Why do you make me see iniquity, and why do you idly look at wrong? Destruction and violence are before me, strife and contention arise. So the law is paralyzed, and justice never goes forth. For the wicked surround the righteous, so that justice is always perverted. Thus says the Lord, our God, look among the nations and see, wonder and be astounded, for I am doing a work in your days. It is so amazing that if I told you, you would not believe it. For behold, I am raising up the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation, who will march through the breadth of the earth to seize the dwellings that are not their own. They are dreaded and fearsome. Their justice and dignity go forth from themselves. Now, I'm going to invite you to stop at verse 7. So that's Habakkuk verses 1 through 7. And I want to also come over to hear, to let you hear in chapter 2, verse number 1. Habakkuk responds to God. I will take my stand at my watchpost and shall station myself on the tower, and I will look out and see what he will say to me, and I will answer concerning, and how he will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord said to Habakkuk, verse 2, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, so that a runner who reads it may know it. For still the vision awaits its appointed time. It will come, and it is not a lie. If it seems slow, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Amen. Once again, I invite you to join us from hearing the words of the Old Testament prophet Habakkuk. I invite you to join me from this, the final edition of the Motown series, What's Going On? What's Going On? My brothers and sisters, have you ever wondered why God has not moved? Have you ever wondered why God has chosen to sit idly by? Have you ever wondered how long would you have to suffer an injustice? Or how long would people you love have to go through a tragic dilemma? If you have lived long enough on this earth, if you are in this stratosphere, then you have wondered at some point how long will people have to suffer the challenges and the travails and the vicissitudes of life? Do you have a loved one who has endured a long sickness or illness? Do you have a friend who has found themselves going over and over again and finding relationships difficult and finding marriage and love almost obscure? Do you yourself have to put in application after application to find out that the job has been filled, you are overqualified, or it's just not the right fit? My brothers and sisters, I've discovered that everyone has to ask the question at some point in their life, how long? As a matter of fact, when we're honest, the how long experiences of life are going to meet us no matter what address we live in. There are million-dollar stars. There are athletes who have also had to answer or ask the question, how long do I have to wait until my opportunity for breakthrough comes? Well, I've come to tell you that you're in good company. Beloved, back in the 1970s, particularly 1971, one of my favorite, well, not one, my favorite artist, the Reverend, I call him the Reverend, the maestro himself, Marvin Gaye, was given credit for writing, well, I should tell you the truth, the great song, What's Going On, that appeared on Marvin's album in 1971, was originally written by, you get this, one of the Four Tops. You remember the song, I'll Be There, or Reach Out, I'll Be There. Well, one of the original Four Tops was one of the writers of the song. And the truth be told, this song, What's Going On, family started out as a love song. It was interesting because one of the Four Tops had seen some police brutality happen, and he began to want to address it through music. And what he did was write. But Berry Gordy told him that he did not like the song because it had too much of a political bend to it. So he rewrote it, rearranged it. The Four Tops writer rearranged it, a member of the Four Tops. And along with two other writers, they made it a love song. And when it seemingly still did not make Berry Gordy attracted to it, they decided to take it to, you got it, Marvin Gaye. Marvin took one look at it, and he himself was dealing and wrestling with some forces and some agitation in his life. His brother had just returned from Vietnam, and Vietnam had done a number on him, and he was just not the same. He had also experienced the loss of Tammy Terrell, and he had not gotten over his co-star Tammy's death. He was wrestling also with the issues that he and his family were having, and he was in a dark and deep and struggling place. Marvin took one look at it and said to the other writers, "This cannot be a love song. I've got to tell the story of what's on the inside of me and what's happening in America." Marvin then took the song, gave it new melody, gave it new lyrics, rearranged it in such a way, and when he finished, the writers who were assisting him originally said, "You are the only one that can do this song." And so Marvin went to Barry and announced to him that he'd like to record What's Going On This Way. Barry Gordy pushed harder back against it. Marvin eventually had to say to Barry Gordy, "Listen, if I don't get to record this my way, then I'll leave Motown." And all of a sudden, you got it. Barry gave in, and this powerful song, this anthem of the 70s, which in truth, when you fast forward to 2022, still has relevancy and realism even now. Carrie, it simply says, "What's going on?" You know, it starts out, beloved, the song starts out as a party. Yeah, and everything is everything. I remember hearing that word and wondering back when I was a little boy, what does it mean that everything is everything? Even at this very moment, I hear people say, "Well, man, how you doing?" And someone will bellow out, "Well, you know, everything is everything." That really doesn't tell me what you're going through or how you feel or how things are going. It lets me know that there's something happening inside of you and you're not quite able to articulate with feeling words what that is. And so Marvin starts this powerful and memorable song out with the party sort of kind of going on. And as people are talking and jiving one with another, the music begins to play, and as it begins to play, it, like the original Reach Out Four Tops, has a whirlwind kind of feel to it. My brothers and sisters, what's so powerful is Marvin starts to bellow out words to address the women in society. You do know that mothers and women are the cradle makers of society. They are the birth canal of everything that humanity knows. And Marvin simply says, "Mother, mother, there are far too many of you who are going through, too many crying, too many having to watch and see children lose their lives." And then he says, "Brother, brother," he's speaking directly to his own brother in this instance. He says, "There are far too many of you dying." The issue that he's lifting politically and socially is that there are wars upon wars that are happening, and too many brothers are dying, too many black, white, and other brown brothers are dying, and there's nothing but more war. If we would pause right now and put a kickstand of hermeneutical and prophetic movements down at this moment, what we have to announce is there are far too many brothers, and I gotta be honest, sisters dying. Too many wars are being fought to make other countries rich, and there is nothing changing. I've come to announce that there's one way to change the trajectory of humanity, and that is to properly give the ultimate gift that God has given to us, and that is love. Marvin writes that there are not only far too many of you dying, he includes the father, and it exposes a little bit of his song. It exposes a little bit of the challenge that he's having with his own father. He says, "Father, we don't need to escalate." My brothers and sisters, he's addressing that every now and then tensions in life don't need to be escalated by the macho attitude. The fake sense of masculinity cannot escalate and cause more problems. That is, if I may tell you the truth, what we're having happening right now. There doesn't need to be any escalation of any laws that are going in the wrong direction. AR-15s, oh, well, let me stop. I don't want to go there. But you know, this story, this what's going on, has relevancy right now. When you pick up the newspaper, when you pick up your phone, when you look on the television, we are in the middle of another chaotic experience. In Buffalo, New York, we pray for them. And in Texas, we pray for them. And I have come to announce it's not over. The summer has not yet come. The temperature is not yet risen as high as it will rise. And we are in the midst of trouble. And I've come to tell you, make this announcement. This is not flesh and blood. This is prophecy. It's not over. We're going to have to mourn more lives. We're going to have to struggle in order to get people to understand that the wages of sin is death,
But God's got a gift of eternal life that awaits all of us, and it comes through the instrument and the gift called love. Marvin says, what's going on? And I bellow these words in the middle of what we're dealing with in society right now. What's going on? What's going on? There are far too many of our children, our brothers, our sisters, our fathers, and our mothers who are suffering and dying. And for what? What's going on? If you've ever wondered what's going on, you are in great company. There is a prophet by the name of Habakkuk who also at one time in life wondered what's really going on. He wondered by asking a question, how long? And my brothers and sisters, if you've ever wondered what's going on and asked the question, how long, our God, shall we experience the challenges and the travail and the high water circumstances of life as we know it now in the year 2022? How long? What's going on? If you've ever wondered that, my brothers and sisters, this is a great preacher to listen to. He makes Motown sounds. Marvin would exactly be who he would be listening to. He would play Marvin and he would say, what's going on? It wouldn't be sexual healing. It wouldn't be I want you, which is my favorite. It would simply be what's going on, because there's something happening now that needs to be addressed. And brother and sister, Habakkuk, who many of you may not know, is a minor prophet with a unique purpose. I want to say that there's a reason that there is a minor prophet section, and there is a reason there is a major prophet section. It is not because they were short or they were small in stature or their word was not relevant. They are called minor prophets because their books are so short, and they're called major prophets because their books are so lengthy and long in your reading, not because they were less or more than anybody else. Habakkuk is a minor prophet. He only has 3 chapters to get his message to God's people, but he has a unique gift. He is not speaking the words of God to the people of God. Habakkuk is actually speaking our word to our God. One of the reasons that I lean in on the book of Habakkuk at seasons like this and times like this is because Habakkuk has the courage, the unmitigated gall, the sagacity even, to suggest to God that you got to answer and give an account for what's going on in this society. Habakkuk takes our pleas, our wounds, our worries, and he lays them before our God. If you really want to know how to lay something out before God, you can look in the Psalms, but you can also look at the prophet Habakkuk. And you know, he gets real out there with God. And some of you may be wondering right now, is it all right that I question God? Well, I come to tell you, if you can't ask any questions of the God you serve, you need to get another God, because there are a God who cannot handle the questions of humanity is not much of a God. But we serve, I know the God that I have has never fallen back, stepped back, or been afraid of the questions or the accusations that I have thrown at God with my human intellect. Oh, God can handle it, my brother. God can handle it, my sister. God is not afraid of the questions that humanity has ever raised in society. God is able to stand up and handle your questions when you ask. Habakkuk says, God, people are suffering. God, people are going through. God, people are dying and experiencing trouble. How long? And hear him in verse number 1 in chapter 1. He says, how long, O God? How long, God? How long shall you watch as your people suffer challenges? He says, God, how long shall iniquity? And he gets real personal. He says, God, how long you gonna watch? How long you gonna make me watch injustice? I don't know about you, but every time I turn on a television, I not only say how long, but I really say, what's going on? God, if you are God, what's really going on? When the world is in a position where legislators are afraid to give equal justice to men and women of color. How long? We've been marching for years, hundreds of years. We fought wars. Our ancestors died in the Civil War so that we might have a better life than they did. How long are we going to have to see black men shot down? How long are we going to have to watch black women strung up and hung and die in very difficult circumstances? How long are we going to have to bury sons and daughters? How long are children going to fear going not only to school, but into a sanctuary? How long before God tells legislators to have the courage to stand up to the capitalistic bullies in society and put some legislation together that will guarantee that humanity behaves in a righteous way? I know you can't legislate behavior, but there has to be some laws put in place. The only law should not be capitalism. The only law should not be kill or be killed. The only law should not be bigger guns and bigger jobs. There has to be a moment where God steps in. How long, God? Habakkuk is echoing our cry thousands of years later. How long do we have to endure the silence of God? Habakkuk says, Lord, how long? And while we are asking the question, and God is put on the stand by Habakkuk, a holy man. Let me share with you that Habakkuk is a prophet, but he is a professional prophet. Brother been to school for the priesthood. The brother has studied the word. The brother is a doctor of theological education and a doctor of hermeneutics. He is no fly-by-night jackleg preacher. He is not someone you see on the street. He is a learned, educated, and prepared servant of the Most High God who understands the way of God. And let me say that even those of us who are prepared for the will of God, who study the algorithms of God, even some of us have to ask the question as we see what we're going through now, how long? Are good people going to suffer? Are righteous people going to not get their breakthrough? How long are people who pray day and night going to have to sit by and watch those people who don't pray at all get the advancement in society? Oh God, how long will cancer ravage humanity? How long will people die from cancer and other diseases and sicknesses when there is a cure for them in the place? How long? God responds to Habakkuk. As God responds to Habakkuk, God also responds to us. I'm almost finished. And God says, take a look around you and make sure that you look good. Something is happening. And if I told you, you would still not believe it. In essence, Habakkuk, I'm not sitting idly. Let me tell you what I'm going to do. Sometimes you have to be careful what you ask God for, because you just might get it. That's a word for somebody. You've been praying. You've been asking God to do something. You better be careful how you approach the throne of God. You better be careful what you lay on the altar of your heart and want God to do, because God has the ability to do just that. Habakkuk says, how long? What are you doing? How come and why? And God says, you ain't seen nothing yet. I'm going to take the nastiest, filthiest, meanest, low-down nation, and I'm going to use them as a borrowed razor to scrape away the insistent ugliness of my people. Habakkuk, I ain't sitting by idly. I'm raising up filthy, nasty, mean, and low-down nations to take over and handle and purge my people. Woo! Habakkuk, the children of Israel are not going to go free from their misusing my gift. The United States of America is not going to get away with her lowdown and treacherous ways. God is raising up something, and it's happening now, whether you recognize it or not. And as God raises to help purge America, we are unable to stop who and how God chooses to purge this nation and this world. Because I don't want to make the mistake in saying that we are the chosen people of God only. But God is working to purge God's people of their sinful ways. And we are not able to determine who or what God uses to do the purging. God says, I'm going to use a filthy nation called the Chaldeans. And the Chaldeans are going to do what I need them to do. They're going to bring you to your knees. And when they get you to your knees, you're going to holler for help. And I am the only help that you shall know. And when God finishes speaking to Habakkuk bags up. Every now and then, when God gives you a word, it's not a time to dance and shout. It's not a time to spin around. It's not a time to lift your hands. It's time for you to go sit your behind down and be still and watch God work. That's a word for somebody. You so busy doing, and you hadn't sit down somewhere and watch God work stuff out. That's prouder of your anxiety. You aren't God. You can't figure this thing out on your own. Sit down and let God be God. My old pastor would say, sit down. You can't box with God. Your arms aren't long enough. Let me go. My brothers and sisters, as Marvin says, what's going on? As Habakkuk has said, how long? What's going on? God responds and says, you want to know the truth? Like that movie back in the day would say, you can't handle the truth. God lays the truth on the line. Habakkuk bangs that thing up. And he has nothing to say outside of chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. I got to go, but this is good. What and how does he respond? Here it is, and we're done. Habakkuk says, well, since you're going to do all of that, God, all I can do is wait on my post and sit still and watch you do your thing. Let me see. What, Habakkuk? Yeah. I'll sit on my post. Read it. Chapter 2, verse 1. I'll sit on my post as a watchman and let you do your thing and I'll watch. Now, you do know that God has said, wait. And when things that we're experiencing now happen, what shall we do? Habakkuk says, when you want to know how long, when you want to know what's going on, and God responds that I'm doing something that you wouldn't believe, even if I told you. And I want to pause. I got to preach this and let you know that in the midst of your life and mine, where chaos, confusion, this is not communal, this is personal to you, is taking place when things are not aligning the way you know you want them to align. Hear the Lord say, be still, child. I'm doing something so amazing, so excellent in your world. If I told you, you wouldn't believe it. There's somebody who knows what I'm talking about. When you look back at where you are now, you would have never been able to write the script any better. But the Lord was orchestrating, as the author and the finisher of our faith, was orchestrating, writing chapters, getting you through ups and downs, over hills and mountains, letting you know it ain't no mountain high enough, ain't no valley low enough. God was doing all of that and bringing you to a place when you look back over your life, you never thought you would be where you are. That's a word. Let God keep working your situation out. It's working, and God's the only one that's writing this chapter. Now let me come on back, communal, country, human-wide, or humanity's sake. What shall we do when God has clearly said, I'm doing something you ain't gonna believe? And here is what, and he describes how he's gonna break the sin-filled nations to bring them back to him. Habakkuk says, what you better do is get ready to watch God work. In essence, Habakkuk says to us, with all of this that's going on, the best thing you can do when you can't do anything is to wait on God. I know you don't want to hear it. This is old school, old preacher kind of conversation. But honey, you got to wait on the Lord and be of good cheer. Habakkuk says, I'm going to wait, but I'm just not being still. I'm actively going to look for the Lord. And that's my word to you. When you're wondering what's going on, be like Marvin. Ask the questions, but have the courage to look for a brighter day. Have the courage to have some Habakkuk in your life, to know that God is working in ways that you can't comprehend, but wait with your eyes open, knowing that God still has the power to change your circumstance. Then Habakkuk says, as I wait, what next? As you wait for God, hear the Lord give us and Habakkuk some instruction. Habakkuk, good, you looking for me. Habakkuk, good, you're going to acknowledge me. Remember, acknowledge the Lord in all your ways, and he shall direct your path. Habakkuk, as you wait for me, I've got an assignment for you. Write the vision, make it plain, so that the runner might be able to carry the word that it's going to happen and it shall not fail. Woo, I felt that thing. Every now and then, in the midst of our waiting on breakthroughs, in the midst of us waiting on justice, in the midst of us waiting on legislation from people who are lying and stealing, God says, write what you want down. In essence, in darkness, start writing about the light. In dark places of brokenness and emptiness, start eloquently stating, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is a stronghold of my life. Of what shall I be afraid? Start writing what you want for the Lord to do. Start writing what you know the Lord has told you. Can I shout in this message for me? What God is saying is, write down my promises. Write down what I told you would happen. And don't write it for me, but write it so that those who are walking and talking and rolling and struggling with you can look down and know the Lord will make the way somehow. In the midst of all of these pandemics, our God has made ways for us to survive. Write down what the Lord is going to do. I'm finished. What's going on? What's going on? Mother, mother, there are far too many of you crying. Brother, brother, there are far too many of you dying. What are we going to do? Write down what our families need. Write down the business plans of society to restructure, remold, and make equality a real deal. Write it down. Write down the dream. Write down the announcement. Ain't no need of saying Black Lives Matter if you don't know what matters they are supposed to be. There is no need of marching saying we shall overcome when you haven't written down what you need for overcoming. Write it down. Make it plain so it shall come to pass. Enjoy your weekend. It's something I haven't done in a while. I want to pray for you, and I want to invite you to join the kingdom of God. I want to invite you to join the church. Come on. It's too much hell in the world for you not to have a holy, sacred one protecting you. I'd love to be your pastor virtually or in person. You're welcome to join our family of faith. I love you. God loves you. And be encouraged. Enjoy your weekend. We'll see you next week. What's going on? What's going on?